A very good morning to you all. Welcome to the presentation contest of level 5 students of Path to Success International Mathural. Path to Success International Mathural is a distinctive educational institute aimed to upskill the soft skills and especially oral skills of English language of school-going children. It also provides ample opportunities for its students to exhibit their talents. Today, we are about to begin another significant event of Path to Success International Mathural. The presentation contest of Level 5 students 2022. I take this opportunity and I'm honored to introduce the chief judge of today's event. He's a veteran Toastmaster and the logistic manager of Division B of District 82, Toastmasters International. He's the senior tech lead at HCL Technologies and the chief technology engineer Solutions Australia. Dear parents, students, and guests, let's welcome Mr. Prasad Varanapala Surya on screen. Moving to the next step of the agenda, I wish to give a brief description about the contest. All the contestants are expected to prepare and orally present a PowerPoint presentation on any topic selected under the broad theme of science and technology. The time allocated for a contestant is 5 to 10 minutes. I repeat, the time allocated for a contestant is 5 to 10 minutes. If a contestant encounters an issue of the internet connection, that contestant will be given another attempt after all the other contestants presented. We expect all the contestants to maintain strict online meeting etiquette throughout the contest. The timer will record the time consumed by each contestant soon after each presentation. Let's get to know the timer of today's event, Nathan Jayavikrama. Nathan Jayavikrama is a timer of today's event. Now everything is ready to begin today's contest. I wish all the best for all the contestants. Let's start the contest. Contestant number one, Minaga Sanviru. I hope that you are ready. I'll put you on spotlight. And you can share the screen and start the contest. Start your presentation.
Teacher, can you see my screen?
Yes, we all can see your screen.
Good morning, everybody. Respected judges, teachers, and my dear friends. My name is Minaga Sanviru. I'm in grade 10 and I am a level 5 student of Students English Program of Path to Success International Mathural. Today, I'm going to talk about a new. In this universe, there are many various of types of stars and planets. What if there are some planets that would be has an another alien life, like planet Earth? There would be Earth-like exoplanets in this whole universe. But you will be having a question about the meaning of an exoplanet. An exoplanet or extra solar planet is a planet that outside of the solar system. like that, what if there would be a planet that has another alien life? Yes, of course. Now the scientist has been discovered many kinds of exoplanets that can be guessed to have another alien life. So today I'm going to talk about a special exoplanet that also can be guessed to have an alien life. That is Kepler-22b. First, I'm going to talk about the main details of this planet. Kepler-22b and the Earth distance is 600 light years. That means 180 BC. That is pretty far from the Earth. The host star of this planet is Kepler-22. It is 4 billion old. This planet was discovered by NASA's Kepler telescope in December 2011. Kepler-22b's radius is roughly 20.4 times that of Earth. Its mass is 52.8 meters Earth. That means it's 36 Earths. The temperature of this planet is 22 degrees Celsius. Now you can see a picture of a size comparing between Kepler-22b and the planet Earth. Now let's talk about the habitability of this planet. The average distance from Kepler-22b to its host star Kepler-22 is about 15% less than the distance from the Earth to the Sun, but the luminosity, that means light output, of Kepler-22 is about 25% less than that of the Sun. This combination of a shorter average distance from the star and a lower stellar luminosity are consistent with a moderate surface temperature at the distance. If it is assumed that the surface is not subject to extreme greenhouse heating. Also, Kepler-22b is moving highly elliptical orbit. Its surface temperature variable will be very high. Now you can see a picture of the habitability zone of Kepler-22b. A habitability zone is the planet orbits around the Sun. That means it's moving up. Now I'm going to talk about the climate of this planet. Scientists can estimate the possible surface conditions as follows. In the absence of an atmosphere, it's equilibrium temperature. That means assuming an Earth-like albedo would be approximately 262,000. That means 11 minus degrees Celsius. Compared to Earth's 255,000, that means 18 minus degrees Celsius. If the atmosphere provides a greenhouse effect similar in magnitude to the one of Earth, it would have an average surface temperature of 295,000, that means 22 degrees Celsius. Also, if the effect similar in magnitude to the one of on Venus, it would have an average surface temperature of 733,000, that means 460 degrees Celsius. So Kepler-22b is a super Earth that could be covered in a super ocean. The jury is still out on Kepler-22b's true nature. At 20.4 times Earth's radius, it might be even be gaseous, but theoretically an ocean were tipped on its side, a bit like our solar system's ice giant, example for Uranus, turns out to be comfortably habitable based on recent computer modeling. So I hope you learn about many facts about Kepler-22b and what is an exoplanet, sort of that. Maybe we could be seen to Kepler-22b with a spacecraft and observe it one day. So thank you for being with me. Over to you, teacher.
Thank you, Minata. Thank you for taking part in today's contest and enlighten us about that new planet. It was a very descriptive and informative presentation. And let's remain in a few minutes silence for the judge to mark the evaluation sheets. Timer, can you please repeat his time?
The time of contestant number one is 6 minutes and 3 seconds.
6 minutes and 3 seconds. Thank you so much, Nathan. Right, contestant number two, Sarani, can you, you can get ready, you can on the camera. Mr. Prasad, shall we proceed?
Oh, yes, Ms. Priyanti.
Right. Contestant number two, Sarani Hasitma, you can start presenting now.
Good morning, everyone. Respected judge, my dear teacher, and my dear friends. I'm Sarani Hasitma. I'm 15 years old. I'm studying in St. Thomas Girls High School. I'm a level 5 student of Path Sasmatra. Today, I will do a presentation about nanotechnology and share some important facts about nano. Have you wondered about nanotechnology? How much do you know about nanotechnology? From my presentation today, I wish to give you a clear idea about nanotechnology. My presentation outline. First, I'm going to introduce nanotechnology. Then I'm going to share some important facts about nano, then history of nanotechnology. Then I will talk about nanotechnology in different fields like medicine, agriculture, cleaning, and clothes. Then advantages of nanoscience. And last but not least, I will talk about disadvantages of nanoscience. Nanotechnology. Since when does nanotechnology has been used? What is this nanotechnology? Nanotechnology is the efficient creation of nanoscale particles or systemic manipulation of atoms. Normally, atomic packaging does not show a systemic pattern. So normally, atomic packaging is done with large gaps between them. If we can pack those atoms that are irregularly packed, we would have many benefits. We use nanotechnology to pack these atoms properly. Many creations are invented by using nanotechnology. Important facts about nanoscience. Meaning of nano is simple. Nano is a fraction of a billion. Nanometer is a billionth of a meter. We use nanometer to measure the size of things which are invisible to naked eye. To show you how small this nano could be, a single page of newspaper is almost 1,000 nanometers thick. The diameter of a single human hair is 800 nanometers. Nanoscience is not limited to one field. It works as a platform that includes combines biology, physics, chemistry, and engineering. History of nanotechnology. Since when does nanotechnology has been used? To answer that question is, even before 15 years ago, nanotechnology has been used. Even though nanotechnology has not been introduced, it has been used. For example, the nanoscale gold-plated glass. It was made in the 10th century and strong weapons. But the fact is, high-powered microscopes, which are capable of observing nanoscale particles, were discovered 10 centuries later. Nanotechnology started in 1959 by physicist Richard Fehm. He was awarded the Nobel Prize. He's a professor at the University of California. is also known as the father of nanotechnology. He did an amazing speech about nanotechnology. It is called as, there is plenty of room at the bottom. In 1974, a professor called Norio Tombucci, as you can see, named this technology as nano. Nanotechnology in medicine. What are the uses of nanotechnology in the medicine field? Doctors face a problem in curing cancer. That is, the drugs that are given to kill cancer also destroy the normal cells in the body. Scientists believe nanotechnology will be a solution for this problem. Since nanorobots are smaller than blood cells, nanorobots can find the damaged cell and destroy it. Nanorobots can enter the bloodstream and remove the cholesterol. It will help for a painless childbirth. Placement of nanofibers to regenerate worn-out cartilage is really helpful. Nanotechnology in agriculture. Nanosensors will provide data on the growth of plants. Nanosensors network systems are amazing in early detection of disease that can be transmitted to crops by viruses, fertilizers in the soil. Delivery nanocaspers or essential fertilizers and pesticides to the target, effectively nourishing the crop and to process food in a way that does not compromise on quality. Nanotechnology in clothes. Nano researchers have successfully tested wool and silk fabrics, which are made of nanotechnology. So what's the importance of this nanotechnology clothes? These clothes automatically get cleaned. Nanotechnology in cleaning. Nanochemical liquids not only completely remove the lettuce from your house, it also prevents from reaccumulating. Advantages of nanotechnology. It will help in manufacturing the products that will be way cheaper, energy saving, lighter in weight. Nanorobots can be used to rebuild the ozone layer, which will be really helpful. It will be able to clean polluted areas. Energy efficient products such as fuel and solar cells. Advances in disease treatment such as cancer. Better imaging and diagnostic equipment. It brought about a great change in electronic commodities. Last but not least, what are the disadvantages of nanotechnology? In the future, jobs in the traditional farming and manufacturing industry will be lost. Atomic weapons now can be more accessible and made to be more powerful. Since these particles are very small, problems can actually arise from inhaling minute particles. Since people can now develop products at the molecular level, diamonds will also lose its value since it now can be mass produced. Sometimes creation of nanotechnology can be too expensive. It has increased pollution, which includes air pollution. So, my dear friends, if we can minimize those disadvantages and improve the benefits, this will be a blessing to our future, to develop our lives. So let's minimize those advantages and use nanotechnology in the future. Over to you, teacher.
Thank you very much, Sarani, for taking part in today's contest. It was a good presentation about nanotechnology. Then let's time up. Can you please report Sarani's time?
The time of contestant number two is 6 minutes and 30 seconds.
Right, contestant number three, Pamudi Rashmika, can you please turn on the camera? Right. Mr. Prasad, shall we proceed?
Yes, please.
Contestant number two, Pamudi Rashmika, you can start presenting now.
Welcome to Judges, teacher, and my dear friends. I am Pamudi Rashmika. I am in grade 10 of Sujata Vidyalaya Mathura. I am in level 5 of SSC program of Path to Success English Academy. Today, I brought a very interesting topic to discuss with you. So let's see what it is. Do you think that all the living organisms on the earth appeared at once? No, all the living organisms on the Earth is a result of the great evolutionary process which occurred within a long period of time on the Earth. This process is the reason for the great biodiversity on the Earth too. So first of all, let's discuss about the origin of Earth. When we consider about the origin of the Earth, there are two popular theories to be considered. They are nebula theory and Big Bang theory. Even though there are two theories, in both theories, it is believed that the Earth has been originated about 4.5 billion years ago. So first of all, I'll tell you about the nebula theory. This is the first scientific explanation about the solar system. It is believed that the small particles in the universe grew together by the gravitational force, clumped up, and the solar system was formed. The second theory is Big Bang theory. This is the modern theory about the origin of the Earth. The difference between these two theories is, in this theory, they say that the particles which made the solar system were formed by a giant explosion which took place in the universe. Now let's go to the origin of life on the Earth. It is believed that about 3.5 billion years ago, life has been originated on the Earth. When you're talking about the origin of life on the Earth, there are four theories to be considered. They are theory of special creation, theory of spontaneous generation, cosmosoic theory, and theory of biochemical evolution. Now I'll tell you about each theory separately. The first theory is theory of special creation. In this theory, it states that all the living organisms were created by a supernatural power. But there are no scientific evidences to prove this. The second theory is spontaneous generation theory. This theory states that life has originated by non-living things. But this theory has been scientifically disproved now. The third theory is cosmosoic theory. This theory states that life has originated on the Earth by a fallen meteor with living organisms or by a spacecraft of another planet. The fourth theory is theory of biochemical evolution. It is believed that life has originated in the primordial soup, which is formed by dissolving the materials which make life possible in rainwater in the ocean by taking the energy from the lightning and UV rays of sun. Now let's see what evolution is. The gradual development of modern complex organisms from simple organisms is called evolution. It is believed that simple unicellular organisms first appeared on the Earth. Then cnidarians, annelids, and arthropods were evolved from them. By them, the first vertebrate on the Earth, fish, appeared on the Earth. Then amphibians evolved from the fish. They are believed to be the first vertebrate entered to the terrestrial environment. From the amphibians, reptiles evolved. They are totally adapted to the terrestrial environment on the Earth. At last, the birds and mammals has evolved. So let's see the evolution of plants separately. It is believed that first photosynthetic organisms first appeared on the Earth. Then evolutionary less developed plants appeared. Non-flowering plants evolved from them, and at last the flowering plants has occurred. It is believed that the evolution of man has took place about 12 million years ago. The evolution of modern man has started about 5 million years ago. Even though we all accept the evolutionary process, there should be evidences to prove this. So now let's see what are those evidences. There are three evidences to prove the evolutionary process on the Earth. They are evidences from fossil study, means paleontology, geographical animal distribution called biogeography, and comparative anatomy. Have you heard about fossils before? Let's see what are they. Fossil study. Preserved remains of organism, a part of an organism, a trace or traces of a dead organism are fossils. Footprints of some animals, prints of shells of animals, skeletons and teeth of animals, bony rocks and preserved bodies of animals in the ice and tree resins are the examples for them. In these pictures, you can see a print of a shell and a fossil in a tree resin. Have you heard the word living fossils before? In the world, there are some organisms survive even today. retaining their body features unchanged though million years have passed. They are called living fossils. The green colored fish in this picture called Coelacanth was believed to be extinct million years ago, but a fish similar to this extinct fish was found near the Sea of South Africa few years ago. Then the animal in the next picture called Lingula can be found near Tambalagamu Bay in Sri Lanka. Except them, the animals we all know, such as dragonfly and cockroach, are also living fossils. The tree fern or guineahotta tree is also considered as a living fossil. And also, even though there are many species of animals on the earth, we all know that they all can't survive continuously for a very long time. The reason for this also has been explained by a special natural selection theory. It states that there is a competition among organisms for the limited resources on the earth. The species who won the competition get established in that environment and the other species extinct. This is said by father of evolution, Charles Darwin. My dear friends, evolution is an important process which makes the organisms adapted to the changing environment on the earth. The evolutionary process has not been completed up to now. So my friends, there will be more novel species formed from the former species in future. And also the features of man will also be changed with the changing environment. I hope my little effort might have expanded your horizon. Over to the teacher.
Yes, Pamadi, it was a wonderful presentation. Your presentation indeed expanded our horizons about the evolution of the earth. Right. Then can you please stop sharing? Yes, timer. Can you please report her time?
The time of contestant number 3 is 8 minutes and 32 seconds.
Right, let's move to contestant number 4, Meluni Dineth Ma. Can you please turn on your camera? All right, now is the time for contestant number 4, Meluni Dineth Ma, to start her presentation. Contestant number 4, Meluni Dineth Ma.
Good morning, everybody. Respected judges, teacher, and my dear friends. I'm Meluni Dineth Ma. I'm in grade 9. My school is Marathal Pavila Central College. I'm a level 5 student of Students Spoken English Program of Path to Success International Marathal. Today, I'm going to do a presentation about the future technology in the world in year 2050. These are the themes of my presentation. First, I will talk about with you future technology. Then nanotechnology. Then I talk about with you safe driving cars. Then solar energy. Finally, I discussed with you what is the conclusion of this presentation. Future technology, the world in year 2050. In year 2050, it seems like it is urged away. And we envision a completely different world from it. But in reality, it is only 30 years from now. And we can already imagine what will be possible by that time. We have a lot of environmental, social problems, and we can all agree that technology is going to solve all these problems by in year 2050. First, I will talk about you. Nanotechnology. Nanorobotics is a still transpiring technology field that is creating machines or robots whose components are at or near the nanometer scale. One such example is a sensor with a switch about 1.5 nanometers, capable of counting specific molecules in the chemical sample. According to some researchers, in the next 10 or 50 years, our blood may be overflowing with tiny nanorobots that could help to keep us from getting sick or transfer our thoughts to a wireless cloud. The way our smartphones work, we will be able to do with our brains too. The future nanotechnology is closer than it might imagine. In the future, nanotechnology may also allow objects to obtain energy from the environment. Then I will talk about with you what are the major benefits of safe driving car service. Finding a park space in the city easier. The car will be dropped off the bus, then resume on its way to find another fare. Continue to do so throughout the day until the car needs a recharge. Next, safe driving cars will rebuild our cities, leaving space for events in parking lots. Safe driving cars are going to have a major impact on domestic airlines. Safe driving cars are successfully taking all the points in the map, pulling them closer in conjunction. This means that your property must find and present different way to attract visitors to your city in the place. Next, I will talk about with you solar energy. We humans are literally destroying our planet by using non-renewable sources of energy. These energy sources are limited in number and emit toxic substances that consume our planet. We all now understand that solar energy is the future of our planet. With solar power, we never have to worry about running out of energy. And besides, it is environmentally friendly. In coming years, technological advancement will ensure that solar is affordable. It may well be that by in the year 2050, solar will become the most paramount source of energy from electricity generation worldwide. It will also have a positive impact on the environmental and climate crisis. Finally, I will discuss with you about the conclusion of this presentation. It is only a very small part of the bigger future that we will see many times over. If we are heading towards this future, we should also be concerned about the downside. If every sphere of life will be managed by technology, then the jobs of human beings will be lost. All we can do is wait and see what the future holds for this world. I hope that you got many knowledge about the future technology in year 2050. Thank you for listening my presentation. Over to you, teacher.
It was a wonderful presentation about future technology, Meluni. Thank you for taking part in today's contest and also enlightening us about future technology. We'll move to contestant number five. Nathan, can you please report our contestant number four, Nelon Dinesma's time?
The time of contestant number four is 5 minutes and 42 seconds.
Let's move to contestant number five. Contestant number five, Nethumi Nikeshala, can you please turn on your camera and get ready?
Good morning, all of you.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Nethumi. Can you please turn on your camera so that we can see you too? Is it possible for you to turn on your camera? Yes.
Good morning, all of you. Respect a judge, teacher, and my dear friends. I'm Nethumi Nikeshala. I'm in grade 9. My school is Fort Janadhipathi College. I'm a level 5 student of students in spoken English program of Path to Success International Mathare. I'm going to talk about with you hydrothermal vents. Hydrothermal vents. Today I am talk about with you. First, what is hydrothermal vents? What are three types of hydrothermal vents? How are vents populated? Hydrothermal vents happen to animals. What are the causes of it? How do animals survive around hydrothermal vents? And being heated something to over 180 degrees Fahrenheit by the interior of the earth escape through crust crack back into the ocean. Superheated water beneath the oceanic crust often dissolves mineral from nearby rocks as hot vent fluid meet cold ocean water minerals precipitate out of vent fluid. What are three types of hydrothermal vents? Ocean vents eject hot, often toxic fluid and gases into the surrounding seawater. They often mark sites of tectonic activity and create some of most hostile on Earth. Ocean vents are a type of hydrothermal vents. Other types of hydrothermal vents include hot spring glaciers and fumaroles. How are vents populated? Vents are often far apart. They often exist for just a few decades for year. New vents are populated very quickly. Vent bacteria live in deep ocean water in a pore of deep ocean rocks all of the time in how low numbers. When a vent pops up, bacteria population flourish. Hydrothermal vents happen to animals. Hydrothermal vents are home to many kinds of animals, including tapeworms, crabs, mussels, and saucy fish. The octopus is one of the top predators in hydrothermal vents ecosystem. Most hydrothermal vents on mid-Atlantic Ridge don't have the tapeworms, but they do have shrimp, many of which host symbiotic bacteria. What causes hydrothermal vents? Hydrothermal vents are the result of seawater percolation down through fissures in the ocean crust in the vicinity of spreading centers or subduction zones. The cold seawater is heated by hot magma and re-emerges to form the vents. How do animals survive around hydrothermal vents? Organisms that live around hydrothermal vents don't rely on sunlight and photosynthesis. Instead, bacteria What is the importance of hydrothermal vents? Support unique ecosystem and their communities of organisms in the deep ocean. Help regulate ocean chemistry and circulation. Provide a laboratory in which scientists can how life on Earth could have begun. I hope you learn a lot of from my presentation. Thank you. Over to you, teacher.
Thank you, Nethumi. It was a wonderful presentation. Timer, can you please report her time?
The time of contestant number 5 is 5 minutes and 5 seconds.
Right, contestant number 6, Vidat Bindia, can you please turn on the camera and get ready? Please keep the camera on while we are presenting. Right, okay.
Okay.
Right. Contestant number 6, Vidat Bindia, you can start presenting.
Good morning, everyone. I am in grade 10 in Mathura Mahinda Rajapaksha School, and I am a level 5 student of SSC program Fast Success International. Today, I am going to talk with you about teleportation. First, let me introduce you what is teleportation. Teleportation is the hypothetical transfer of matter or energy from one point to another without traversing the physical space between them. This is a very popular concept, but unfortunately, humans have teleported only in science fiction stories. Scientists have tried to teleport humans safely, but it haven't worked. So what happens in teleportation is there are two main parts of this process, dematerialization and materialization. In dematerialization, the object which is subjected to this process is scanned at the dematerialization point and broken to atom-sized particles by a computer and in materialization, another computer at the other point analyzes the data sent by the other computer and build according to that data. The first mention of teleportation is American writer Charles Fort is created with having coined the word teleportation in 1931 to describe the strange disappearances and appearances of anomalies, which he suggested may be connected. As in the earlier usage, he joined the Greek prefix.
Sorry for interruption tele, with that. We can't see your presentation. Any others can see?
No, I too cannot see with that. So you are not in the presentation mode. We cannot see you moving the slides with that. Can you please start from the beginning?
Okay, teacher. Teacher, can you see my screen?
Yeah, I can see your screen, but not in the presentation mode.
Stop share and try again with that. That may solve the problem.
Okay. Can you see it?
You are in presentation mode now. Is it full screen?
Not yet, sir.
Just click on that icon on the bottom. If you can see, presentation is icon on the bottom of the screen with that in the PowerPoint.
Okay.
Yeah, that one, please.
Can you see?
No, still same.
Sir, I think I might have to turn off my camera.
Really? Can you try it?
Okay, sir. I started in on full screen.
No, not in the presentation mode. You are not in the presentation mode, Vidat.
Vidat, while you start sharing the screen, select full screen view to share. That's the issue, I think. I think you can see full screen view, right? But others can't see your PowerPoint view still. Stop share, and while you share, start, while you're going to start share, choose that full screen mode.
Okay, sir.
From there.
Can you see?
Still same. Only we can see your PowerPoint.
So I started.
Yeah, it now that's fine. Me. Yeah, now that's fine.
Okay. Today I'm going to talk with you about teleportation. Teleportation is the hypothetical transfer of matter or energy from one point to another without traversing the physical space between them. This is a very popular concept, but unfortunately humans have teleported only in science fictional stories. Scientists have tried to teleport humans safely, but it haven't worked. What happens on teleportation is there are two main parts of this process. Dematerialization and materialization. In dematerialization, the object which is subjected to this process is scanned at the dematerialization point and broken to atom-sized particles by a computer, and in materialization, another computer at the other point analyzes the data sent by the other computer and builds it according to that data. First mention of teleportation is the American writer Charles Fort is credited with having coined the word teleportation in 1931 to describe the strange disappearances and appearances of anomalies which he suggested may be connected. As in the earlier usage, he joined the Greek prefix tele, which means remote, to the root of the Latin verb porter, which means to carry. Fort's first formal use of the word occurred in the second chapter of his 1931 book, Law. There are several recent experiments on teleportation. In 1998, physicists at the California Institute of Technology, along with two European groups, made IBM's teleportation theory a reality by successfully teleporting a photon, a particle of energy that carries light. The Caltech team read the atomic structure of photon, sent this information across 3.28 feet of coaxial cable and created a replica of the photon on the other side. As predicted, the original photon no longer existed once the replica appeared. In 2012, researchers at the University of Science and Technology of China made a new teleportation record. They teleported a photon 60.3 miles 50.3 miles further than the previous record just 2 years later. European physicists were able to teleport quantum information through an ordinary optical fiber used for telecommunication. Dangers in teleportation are a teleporter might be killing you and creating a copy at the destination, which would leave a vast death toll if teleportation become a common mode of transportation. Since it's really hard to imagine the physics behind creating this, it might be hard to fix in emergency situations. If someone goes somewhere and the teleporter stops working, then a person can be stuck there. There is a myth about an American test on teleportation. In the year 1943, US Navy was conducting an experiment on teleportation. This experiment was called the Philadelphia Experiment, and they did this experiment on the ship named USS Eldridge, close to the coastal city of Philadelphia. First, everything was looking good and going according to the plan. The ship was disappeared as they hoped it would, but when it comes back, not everything was fine. They found out that something has gone terribly wrong during the dematerialization and materialization process. All the sailors in the ship was dead. They have been embedded with the ship, and one was even cut in half. But they conducted another experiment after a few weeks later. That time, the ship wasn't only disappeared, but even has teleported to the US naval base on Norfolk, Virginia. But that time also, lot of sailors were dead and some has gone crazy. But the US Navy refused to accept that this has happened. So it's not entirely sure if this is real. Now, I will show you a video based on teleportation. Its name is The Fly. Sir, can you see the video?
Yeah, we can see the video with that.
Okay, sir.
With that, did you share the sound?
Can't you hear it, teacher?
We can't hear. Did you share your computer sound with us?
I'll check, teacher.
Okay.
I think you're making a mistake. I think you really want to talk to me.
Sorry, I have three other interviews to do before this party's over.
Yeah, but they're not working on something that'll change the world as we know it.
They say they are.
Yeah, but they're lying.
There is a limit, even to the imagination.
Human teleportation, molecular decimation, breakdown, and reformation is inherently purging.
Where our greatest creations meet our deepest fears.
Something went wrong, Seth. When you went through, something went wrong.
You are about to go beyond that limit.
Those weird hairs that were growing out of your back, I had them analyzed. But they were definitely not human.
If you saw how scared and angry and desperate he is...
I'm sure Typhoid Mary was a very nice person, too, when you saw her socially.
No!
You're afraid to be destroyed and recreated, aren't you?
You're changing, Seth. Everything about you is changing.
Oh, no. What's happening to me? Am I dying?
I want to know what's going on.
What does the disease want?
Wants to turn me into something else.
Oh, no.
A fly got into the transmitter pod with me that first time when I was alone. Don't go back to it.
Could be contagious.
I'm afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Be afraid. Be very afraid.
As you see in the video, it can be very dangerous, but if we can remove those dangers and make it safe, it would be very useful in the future. So thank you for being with me. Over to you, teacher.
Thank you, Vidat, for sharing your knowledge about this human teleportation. And with that presentation, the presentation contest came to the end. So this whole contest was a wonderful exhibition of the talents of our students. Let's listen to a wonderful song till the results were finalized.
Sorry, Ms. Priyanti, what about the timing of last presentation?
Oh, right. I'm sorry. Yes, Nathan, can you please report the time of Vidat?
The time of contestant number 6 is 7 minutes and 20 seconds.
Right, let's listen to a beautiful song. Welcome back. I guess our judge is ready to announce the results. Mr. Prasad, are you ready or do you need more time?
Give me one more minute, Ms. Priyanti.
Hi, sure. I respectfully invite our Chief Judge, Mr. Prasad Varnakulasuriya, on screen, and we highly appreciate your constructive comments about the attempts of our students, and then to announce the first, second, and third places and merit award winners.
Thank you, Ms. Priyanti. And before checking the winners, let's move to some comments about your presentations. And I would like to really appreciate your effort you all have done to create your presentation. And those are really wonderful and amazing presentations. Those were really nice presentations. And you all have done a wonderful job. And I like to appreciate that effort you made to create your presentations. Let me point out some of your good points which you have used to added to your presentations. One thing is some of you are used a presentation outline for your presentations. That's good point, because if someone looking at your presentation, then they are waiting to see what are you going to present during your presentation time. Then it's important to have presentation outline in your presentations. That's a good point. And many of you have used some nice graphics, some animations to your presentations. And I've seen some of you made those animations by yourself in the PowerPoint, and that's really great, and it's attractive way to do your presentation and animations as well. And I would like to suggest some of things for your future improvements, and try to use more images in your presentations rather than more contents. Just like add some symbols, images, and do your presentation with those things. As the example, if I need to explain about, let's say, Apple iPhone, then what I do is I'm going to add the image of the phone to presentation, and I prepare my contents, what I need to say about this phone. Then in my presentation, there will be only image of the phone, and I'm going to I'm going to tell content by my own words. That's more important. Try to use your own words rather than using some contents got from the internet. And it's better if you can express that with your own words. And one more thing, try to keep consistency in the slides. As the example, if your title is the red color of the first slide, then it should be red color of the all the slides. If it's a red color in first slide and the blue in the second slides, is not much good. Because in the presentations we need to maintain the consistency of the title colors, fonts, font types, font styles, like that. Those are some of my small suggestions for your future improvements. Rather than that, you have done wonderful presentations, and those were really nice, and you explained really well. And I felt some of really fluent with the English language, and I really understood well about what you tried to explain. And I forgot to mention one more thing. Keep it in mind at title to your presentation. If you missed to add a title to your presentation, then your audience will sometimes get confused about what you are going to say. So in the first slide, you have to show what's the title of your presentation. And rather than that, you all have used nice graphics, animations, images. That's really great, and nice colors, colorful presentation, and those are really informative as well. And I learned a lot from your presentations. That's really great. And as the appreciation to all of us, shall we give us round of applause to all of our competitors? Yes, now it's time for announce the today's winners. I'll start from the merit awards. Merit awards goes to Sarani Hasidma. Shall we have Sarani Hasidma to the screen?
Sarani, yes, turn on the camera, please. Right.
Sarani Hasidma, you have done a wonderful job, and you've done about future technologies. And you took time about 5 minutes and 42 seconds, and we feel you are really fluent, and your presentations also really awesome. And we really appreciate your effort, Sarani.
Thank you, sir.
And next merit award goes to Netumi Nikeshala.
Netumi, can you please turn on the camera? Netumi?
Netumi, you have done a wonderful presentation, and you have done about hydrothermal vents. And we feel you have done your research well, and that was really informative presentation. And it's really great presentation. We would like to really appreciate your effort you have done for your presentation.
Thank you.
And then third place goes to Pamodi Rashmika.
Pamodi
Rashmika, yeah. Pamodi, your presentation was really nice, and you took about 8 minutes and 32 seconds for your presentation. And you have done your research well, and your presentation was prepared well. And yes, that was really nice presentation. Pramodi, we really appreciate your effort you have done for your presentation.
Thank you, sir.
And second place goes to Neluni Dinetma. Neluni. Neluni, you have done a presentation about future technologies, and you took time about 5 minutes and 42 seconds. And yes, in your presentation, you had a session outline, and your presentation was prepared really well. And that's really nice. We really appreciate your effort, Neloni.
Thank you, sir.
And in today's presentation competition, first place goes to Minaga Sanviru. Minaga, you have done your presentation about some new planet in Solar. Then that was really nice, and I felt you you prepared well. And even in your presentation, I took some of custom animations also you used to your presentation, right? Yeah, that's really nice, and your informations also prepared very well. And yeah, you have used some video clips also to do your presentation. That's really attractive, Minaga. That's really great, and we really appreciate your commitment and your effort, and that's really great.
Thank you, sir.
And every others also, Vidat Vindi also, you also done a wonderful presentation with that about teleportation. That was really great. And everyone try to use more images for your presentations without using more contents, and that will help you to make your presentation more attractive, and then try to explain those terms or facts with your own words. Yes, that's my suggestion for your future improvements. And you all have done a wonderful job. Good luck all. Over to you, Ms. Priyanti.
Thank you, Mr. Prasad. Thank you, Mr. Prasad. We value your constructive comments given for the development of our students. And let's welcome on screen again the winners of today's contest. First place goes to Minaga. Minaga, can you please turn on your camera? Yes, let us all give him a big round of applause to appreciate him. Right, and the second place winner, Neluni Dinetma. All right, and the third place goes to Pamodi. Right, these are the winners of today's contest. We'll give them a big round of applause again. And then let's welcome the Merit Award winners, Sarani and Netumi. Sarani, where are you? Sarani and Netumi. Yes. These are the winners of today's contest. And once again, we extend our gratitude for accepting our invitation and present here as the judge amidst a very busy schedule of work. Mr. Prasad, we wish you all the very best in your future life, and we wish to see your appearance again in our future competitions too. Can we all please give a big round of applause to the judge of today's event, Mr. Prasad Varnapleswarya? Right. Time has come to draw the curtain of this wonderful event. I hope all our guests are enlightened with new knowledge. I express my sincere thanks for all the students who worked hard to make this event a success in making presentations. And also I should thank their parents who guided and facilitated them. Without your contribution, this event would not be a success. Hope to see you again. Till then, goodbye and stay blessed.
Goodbye, teacher.
Goodbye, teacher.